Good evening. We're celebrating Stravinsky tonight and Beethoven. Beethoven, who got shortchanged last year for his 250th anniversary. I still remember the day when the news came that Stravinsky had died in 1971. I believe it was April 6th. It was quite a shock. And so we're going to play the Suite Italienne from 1920. In 1919, the impresario of the Ballet Russe in Paris, Sergei Diaghilev, surprised Stravinsky. They hadn't had any contact for about almost 7 years or so. Of course, World War I happened. And he surprised Stravinsky with fragments and individual movements of music by the Italian composer Giovanni Battista Pergolesi, whose works Stravinsky loved already. He called his music in the Spanish style. Pergolesi was from Naples, I believe, and he died very young, I think at age 26. So Stravinsky initially was reluctant to deal with this pile of music, but little by little he got to love it and came up with the Pulcinella. And Diaghilev, as usual, the brilliant impresario, had set it up with paintings by Pablo Picasso and choreography by Leonid Machin, who followed Nijinsky as the star dancer and choreographer of the Ballet Russe. Stravinsky made various arrangements of the Pulcinella, which by the storyline follows the Commedia dell'arte of the Italian theater. Pulcinella is the main protagonist, who hankers after all kinds of girls and rarely succeeds. So there is an orchestral version, which gets played fairly often for a large chamber ensemble. And then concurrently, he made two versions of the Suite Italienne for violin and piano. The first one he did alone, remarkably, and the second one, which we are playing, he was aided by Samuel Duskin, who had premiered the violin concerto with him.
Thank you.
fast forward some 20 years, it's the Second World War. Stravinsky finds himself in Madison, Wisconsin, where the Pro Arte Quartet, a Belgian ensemble that was founded in 1914 by a French violinist, Alphonse Onou, to whom he dedicated this elegy that I'm about to play, originally for viola solo. And it was dedicated to the violist in the quartet, which soon thereafter disbanded and was taken over, interestingly, by Rudolf Kolisch of the Schoenberg Circle. And they had a residency at the University of Madison, Wisconsin. So the year is 1944, wartime. It's a very somber elegy for this founder of the Pro Arte Quartet, Alphonse Onou. And it was dedicated to the violist Germain Prévost. And it's muted throughout.
Thank you.
Now, to Beethoven, who needs no introduction, of course. He wrote 10 violin sonatas. This is the last. The previous one was the infamous Kreutzer Sonata, which is a huge workout. It takes 45 minutes. This is a meager half an hour next to it. In this piece, in the peaceful key of G major, he avoids any virtuosity. It's an island of serenity, calmness, tranquility, especially in the first two movements. I won't go into the key relationships. The second movement is an E-flat, which makes a return in the last movement. Let me explain. Whereas the Kreutzer Sonata was written for a virtuoso originally called George Bridgetower, with whom Beethoven caroused in wine houses, and who must have been an amazing violinist. Only later, when they had a falling out, was the piece dedicated to Rudolf Kreutzer, the famous author of the 42 etudes for violin and various violin concerti. But this sonata is dedicated to the French violinist Pierre Rode, R-O-D-E, who also wrote 24 caprices, which are really quite lovely pieces, worthy of being performed in concert. He also wrote, I believe, 9 violin concerti. Now, by this time, Rode was in Moscow at the Tsar's, maybe St. Petersburg, I'm not sure, in the employ of the Tsar. And this saying goes that he had lost his virtuosity. And Beethoven, there's actually a comment where he says, we like our last movements to be rousing and brilliant, but Rode doesn't like that. So he must have taken that into account. He uses a set of variations, I believe 5 or 6, on a popular tune, which apparently was taken from a Singspiel, which is sort of the operetta or a musical, if you want, that was popular in Vienna at the time. This piece is, in my opinion, Opus 96, is not considered the late style, but contrary to the Opus 97 Archduke Trio. By the way, they're both dedicated to this Archduke Rudolf of Austria, which is a very generous piece. This is very special and introverted, and it's the late style, looking at the late piano sonatas and the string quartets. It's sublime. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you.